I've been freelancing for about 2 years now, so I thought it was time to make a video about some of the lessons I've learned, mistakes I've made, and my overall experience as a freelance graphic designer. The first thing I want to talk about is working from home. Working from home for me personally has been one of the best things for my career. I like to set up the space how I want it, be able to work the hours that I like, and overall not have to sit in traffic every day and commute and waste time. Not only does commuting waste time, but it also wastes energy, so I feel like I get a lot more done working from home. It took me a while to get this space exactly how I like it, and I didn't think I'd have a home office this soon in my career after graduating college. So I'm very grateful, and I've definitely come a long way since just working on my laptop in the Section 8 apartment with my mom. However, working from home is not always perfect. There are a few big cons to working from home. One thing I've noticed about working from home is people may take your work hours and your boundaries a little less seriously, like friends or roommates may try to get you to do things because you're not actually at work, you're just at home. But I've really had to try to stay disciplined and minimize distractions so none of that stuff comes into play. Another thing I've noticed that didn't really hit me until the second year of freelancing is honestly that working from home can be pretty isolating at times. I don't miss having to go into the office every day, and I definitely don't miss the commute, but sometimes it can get lonely just working from home and not having someone to bounce ideas off of or critique your work or just overall have some chats like here and there. Besides working from home and trying not to get distracted and occasionally wanting to talk to someone to bounce ideas off of, I think working from home is a net positive. Next thing I want to talk about is how when you're a freelancer, the work can definitely be inconsistent. When I first started freelancing, I had a bunch of clients lined up and emails were rolling in and I was getting a lot of work. I was making as much money as I was at my full-time job, and that felt good. That lasted for about 6 months or so, and then I had a 2-month dry spell that definitely helped frame my perspective on the inconsistencies of freelancing. I've experienced plenty of feasts and famines throughout my time as a freelancer, and I've learned the best strategy is to figure out the minimum amount of money you need each month and don't overspend. That way, on the months that you're having good months and a lot of money is coming in, you have a nice little safety net for those future months where maybe things are slow and you're not making enough money that month. This applies to time as well. Sometimes all the projects are coming in at once and you don't even have enough time to work on them, and then other times you're wishing you would just get an email for another client project to come in. I try not to get overwhelmed during the times where I'm working on like 2, 3, 4 projects at once and learn to enjoy the breaks when there's not as many clients, rather than being stressed about when I'm gonna work on my next thing. Thankfully for me, even though sometimes it gets pushed to the last minute and I'm really worried about when my next project's gonna come in, it usually ends up working out. So speaking of those slow months, I found the best way to approach these is to find a balance of personal work, side projects, and hobbies that are engaging enough to keep your brain creative, keep you busy, but not too much to burn you out. That way you have energy for the projects coming up. I think I'm a little bit guilty of overworking because when things are slow, I usually dedicate a lot more time to the YouTube channel, content, personal work, or learning some kind of new hobby. I think it's good to stay busy though and double down when the times are slow because it prevents you from getting lazy and keeps you kind of in that rhythm. That way when projects come in, you're not used to just chilling all that week. I found that if I take a break for too long, I start to dread the work coming up. But if I stay somewhat consistent and keep my brain active and kind of stay in a similar routine, when new projects come in, it's not as much of a jarring adjustment from the slow times. On the other hand though, doing too much can definitely burn you out, and rest is important, so make sure to find that balance and figure out what works best for you. That's a nice segue into this next one, and it's find out a routine that works for you. I have my own routine and it's not for everyone, so it's important to know your mind and body and figure out a work-life balance that works best for you. For me, I prefer to work similar to like office hour jobs, so I usually work anywhere from 9 or 10 to like 4 or 5. I found I'm most productive in those times, and it helps to be active during the times other people are in their office, so if I need to answer emails or whatever it may be. I've also learned about myself after freelancing that I'm pretty particular about my daily routine, and when it gets interrupted, it kind of stresses me out and throws me out of the flow of the workday. For me, when I found I have a nice routine and I do the same type of stuff every day, it allows me to be more creative in the work because I have less decision fatigue around all the other stuff in my life. So a lot of times I eat similar meals, drink the same kind of coffee, and do the same morning routine. That way, I can get real creative and experimental in my work because my environment is a nice constant. So what I usually do is I wake up, do a small workout, drink a protein shake, make my coffee, and then work all the way till about lunchtime. From there, I eat my lunch, and depending on what else I have to do left in the day, I usually work till about dinner time. And then after I eat dinner, I usually just watch YouTube, play video games, or hang with my girlfriend. The weekdays are pretty simple for me. but I like it. This next one's pretty important, and it's that I've learned to make time for stuff you enjoy outside of work. As I mentioned in my routine, I enjoy doing things later in the day that are outside of working. If you want to have a sustainable career as a freelancer, I think you have to enjoy the things outside of work and put just as much value on those as the work itself. This was a lot harder for me to adjust to at first because during COVID, I feel like it messed up my perspective and kind of skewed the whole work-life balance and flipped it on its head. But now I realize how crucial for your mental health it is to enjoy things outside of just working all the time. Working from home has saved a lot of my mental energy from not having to commute and talking to coworkers and stuff. So it's actually made me enjoy doing things more outside of work and makes me want to hang with friends and stuff more, even on the weekdays. I used to be more of an introvert, but I think I realized it wasn't just my base personality, but it was the fact that work and all the stuff surrounding going to an office, commuting and all that was so draining that it made me not want to do those things. So I'm glad I have the freedom to set up my time how I like it. That way I can enjoy the other things that I want and kind of reap the rewards of being a freelancer and being able to set your own schedule. So nowadays I try to go out with friends more, go for walks, go to bars, go out on the weekends, eat nice dinners or whatever I can do whenever I have some extra time. It's crucial to get enough rest and relaxation so you don't burn yourself out. And these don't have to be super intensive activities either. Even just relaxing on the couch or reading a book, recovery is crucial. I made a whole video a while back about how rest and recovery isn't just the absence of work, but something that's just as important in the creative process. So I'll link that in the description too. Basically, if you have more freedom and flexibility to set up your schedule how you like, take advantage of that as a freelancer and don't work yourself to death. Closed mouths don't get fed. I'm sure you've heard this saying before, and I think it applies a lot as a freelance graphic designer. It can be pretty stressful always waiting on other people to work on your next project or get your next job. So sometimes you have to take the initiative. To give me some peace of mind and not rely solely on other people reaching out to me, I do some of my own reaching out on Instagram, email, and Twitter. This could be simple too. It could just be making a connection with someone that you think is doing something cool on social media, showing interest in a brand that you want to work with, all the way to making a full-on proposal and sending it to someone through email. It's also good to step out of your comfort zone every once in a while and approach someone who may be a potential client in person. This also applies to just being active online. Unfortunately, the internet is a huge part of being a freelancer these days, and whether you like it or not, you have to be active on there. I know there's all these problems that social media poses, but it's important to communicate with your audience and people out there that you want to work on stuff. So you can make a cool graphic, throw it on your Instagram story or your Twitter so people know you want to get hired. I think designers are often too embarrassed to put themselves out there and talk about how they want to work on stuff, but at the end of the day, that's how the projects come in, and it doesn't really matter what people think about you if you want to put yourself out there and work. So speaking of social media and reaching out to people, it's important to diversify your lines of communication with your potential clients. Don't rely on just one method of marketing. If all you do is post on Instagram, then every once in a while, try reaching out to people by email, browsing LinkedIn, or treating clients well so they'll refer you by word of mouth. The way I currently let people know that I'm a designer and I want to work on projects these days is either in person, through email, my website and portfolio, my newsletter, link in the description if you want to sign up, Instagram, Twitter, and I guess in a way, YouTube. You don't have to always be promoting yourself and using every single one of these platforms all the time, but it's just important to not put all your eggs in one basket. This one's super important, and it's put out the type of work that you want to be doing. When promoting yourself, it's not just about letting people know that you're ready to work, but it's showing them what type of work you want to be doing. In the graphic design world, there's so many different types of things you can work on, so it's important to somewhat niche down and just show the people the type of stuff you want to work on and showcase your skills online. The best type of marketing we can do as designers is inspire our future clients. Put out good work, and then that'll give them the inspiration to want to hire you for future stuff. Putting out good design work and the type of design work that you want to work on consistently is honestly the best way to get hired. It sounds simple, but that's just the reality. The reason it's important to put out the type of work that you want to be doing is you want to be recognized for that type of work. If you really want to get into logo design or brand identity, your Instagram, your portfolio, your socials, whatever should be filled with that. That way the clients see that over and over, and when they think, oh, I need a logo designer or I need a web designer, they'll think of you. It also goes the other way. even if you worked on a super cool client project or a big client and it's something that you want to brag about or be proud of, if it's not the type of work you want to be doing in the future, I would hesitate to putting that out there too much, because you'll probably get hired for the same thing over and over, and then you'll fall into that trap of working on the same type of stuff all the time that you don't really enjoy. So don't be afraid to experiment, but be somewhat selective about what you put in your portfolio and stuff, because you want it to be the type of work you're proud of, you want to be known for, and you want to be hired for again. As a freelancer, you need to keep track of your finances or hire someone to do it. Money is just a stressful reality of life, and as a freelancer, you have to be on top of it more than ever. When you're an employee, they handle a lot of the taxes, insurance, and all that other shit. So as a freelancer, you have to be more disciplined with your finances than ever. And if you're not the type of person who wants to save money for taxes, keep track of all your write-offs, invest, or whatever, then hire someone who will do that for you. For me personally, I don't think it makes sense to hire someone, because I learned a lot of stuff online on my own. So I know how to do my taxes, I know what to invest in, and I'm pretty responsible with keeping track of all my finances. But I know a lot of people get really stressed out by that stuff, and if you don't enjoy it, then it doesn't hurt to have someone help you. So some quick tips, but not financial advice, are these. For me, living in California, I save about 25 to 30% of the money for each project that I work on for taxes. If you have extra money, set up a Roth IRA or whatever the equivalent is in your country, basically a retirement investment account. And what's nice about it is when you withdraw it later when you're old, it doesn't get taxed. Keep track of all the things that you buy for write-offs in the future, everything from design books to computer equipment to office supplies, whatever. When you work with clients, always have a proper contract and invoice and charge at least 50% upfront. If possible, save a little bit of cash each month to build up an emergency fund of 3 months of living expenses. I know that can be hard, but if you can build it slowly and slowly, it'll be nice to not have that stress when work is slow. Raise your rates and be selective when you can. With inflation and all the expenses that go into being a freelancer, I always try to raise my rates here and there. If you worked as an employee, every once in a while when you performed well, you'd probably get a raise or a promotion, right? As time goes on, you become more valuable. Your skills as a designer increase, and you can be a little bit more selective with the projects that you work on, either by turning down stuff that doesn't interest you or just pricing yourself out of smaller red flag type of projects. If you aren't getting told no or ghosted by potential clients every once in a while due to your price, then you're probably not charging enough. So on the contrary, money shouldn't be the only factor when considering projects. I made a whole video about what I look for to know if a project will be rewarding or not, and I'll link that below. Basically though, if a job has at least two of these three things, I'll take it on. Make meaningful connections, get paid well, or learn something new. This last thing I want to talk about is a little bit more on the personal type of things, but it's just treat people with kindness and respect and value new connections. Not only am I a designer, but I'm a human, and some of the best personal, creative, and business advice I've ever gotten is basically to just not suck. Be nice to the people you meet and you work with, respect people's time, and value new connections you make, because you never know what it might turn into down the road. If you see someone working on some cool stuff and you're thinking in your head, that's tight, just go ahead and tell them or compliment them on it. Everyone will be better off for it too. You can be the best designer or artist in the world, but if you're a piece of shit as a person, then it doesn't matter. Most people probably won't want to work with you, and overall, your life won't be as fun if you go around acting awful to everyone. So when you get too wrapped up in working on your career, trying to be a successful designer, just make sure along the way you're treating people with kindness and respect. So there you have it, some of the lessons I've learned after freelancing for 2 years. If you enjoyed this video, please hit that subscribe button, and I hope you have a nice rest of your day. Peace.